Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. A major tenet of Electric Universe theory is that electrical currents flowing through the conductive medium of plasma induce powerful magnetic fields at all scales throughout the cosmos. Of course, on our own Earth, the Norwegian experimentalist Kristian Birkeland postulated more than a century ago that electrical current systems produce Earth's auroras, a thesis confirmed many decades ago. Quite recently, it's been discovered that so-called supersonic plasma jets reaching up to 10,000 degrees Celsius in Earth's upper atmosphere are associated with, quote, large electrical fields. Nevertheless, the existence of cosmic electrical currents mostly remains a taboo subject in the astronomical literature. In this episode, author Richard Moore explores from an electrical perspective two fundamental astronomical questions. Why do stars and planets have magnetic fields? And why do they rotate?
Why do stars and planets have magnetic fields and why do they rotate? And the standard model offers explanations. But if you're familiar with the EU model, then you have to realize those explanations just really don't make any sense. They're talking about imagined convection currents in a nuclear-powered sun and twisted magnetic field lines and, you know, all those kinds of explanations, which we know aren't valid. Well, I saw Don Scott's presentations on cosmic power lines, and he made clear in that is that the incoming Birkeland current determines the spacing of planetary orbits. He showed that with his Bessel functions. And what that's saying is that there's a massive magnetic field pervading the whole solar system coming in from the Birkeland current. And so I started wondering, what's the relationship between that massive magnetic field and the sun's magnetic field? Do they interfere with one another or what? So that's what got me started thinking, and you know, that's where I came up with the hypothesis that I came up with. For those two questions, we'll start by looking at the sun's magnetic field. Now, most people would just naturally say that the magnetic field is internally generated, some kind of, you know, rotational dynamo or whatever. And that is what the standard model says. However, as I said before, their reasoning is all based on false assumptions. Same thing for the question of why does the sun's magnetic field reverse? I mean, if it is internally generated dynamo, then why would it reverse? It doesn't seem to make any sense. And again, they have a model. What they say is it has to do with twisted magnetic current. So I wanted to think, well, what could the EU say about the sun's magnetic field? Is it an electromagnet? We've got these huge currents coming in at the north and south poles, and so maybe they're acting, sort of playing the same role as a solenoid, creating an electromagnet. Now, for those two questions, we'll start by looking at the sun's magnetic field. Let's look now at a Birkeland current coming in at the North Pole. We'll just take half of it for now. There's one at the South Pole as well. Try to think of the Birkeland current as if it were a solenoid. Now, the problem with that is that the Birkeland current is made up of concentric cylinders, and each cylinder tries to induce an opposite field. So it's even one Birkeland current on its own is rather complicated as if you think of it as a solenoid. However, in Don Scott's talk, he showed us this first-order Bessel function, which gives us the strength of the current in each of the cylinders. And it's clear from that diagram that the central cylinder dominates. It's considerably more powerful than any of the other cylinders. And so to some extent, the other cylinders, you might say, cancel one another out, and it's really the central cylinder, to a first approximation, that is going to act as a solenoid on the sun. So what we have then is two central fields opposing one another to a first approximation, and each of them is trying to induce an opposite field because they're both, looking at the pole they come in at, they're rotating clockwise, both of them. So that's opposite torques and opposite magnetic fields. So what the result is going to be, if we assume that one of those is going to be slightly larger than the other, then we can kind of do a vector addition of the two fields, and what we end up with is a smaller field with the same orientation as the larger of the two incoming fields. So that smaller field is then acting on the sun. And then the sun being, you know, it's going to have a lot of iron in it, because stars are created in Z pinches, and that's where the heaviest ions are concentrated. So that field coming in from the Birkeland current, the net field of the two currents, is going to be amplified by the ferric sub, just the way when you put an iron rod in a solenoid, then suddenly you've got a strong magnetic field. Without the iron rod, you don't. So that explains why there's a magnetic field from an EU point of view. Now the question of why does the field reverse every 11 years? Well, that could simply be that the relative strength of the two incoming currents changes. So if the one at the north is stronger, then we get a net field that gets amplified by the sun. It has one polarity. But then if the one from the south becomes stronger, then the net polarity is going to reverse. So it's not really a mystery. We only need to just ask the question is there a shift in the relative strength of those two fields? And if there is, then that would explain the reversal of the magnetic field. So my conclusion from all of that is that the sun is an electromagnet, because that explains the source of the magnetic field and explains the reversal of the magnetic field. And all of these arguments with respect to the sun really apply to other stars, to planets, and to the Earth. So the hypothesis I'm putting on the table here is that all stars and planets are electromagnets. So then we come to our second question. Why do stars and planets rotate? Well, that net incoming current, that net incoming magnetic field, also exerts a net torque. But of course, the angular momentum of planets and stars is so tremendous, so large magnitude, that we probably would hardly even notice the effect of the torque of the current. Although someone made the point that there's a slight variation in the day that correlates with solar ejections, which would sort of be an indication that there you can actually measure it on some small, tiny scale, the effect of the incoming torque. So the question then is, what's the source of the original rotation? So what we could look at there is we've got an image of a stellar nursery. Now, what's happening in a stellar nursery is you've got all these Birkeland currents that are in glow mode, creating Z pinches and creating stars and planets. Those are much stronger currents than our current sun is. You know, we don't have any glow mode current coming into our sun. It's much less energetic once stars settle down. But when they're being created, you've got very strong fields, magnetic fields, and strong torque acting on these newly born celestial objects. So my hypothesis there is that stars and planets spin up as electric motors. So basically what I'm saying is that stars and planets act as electromagnets and as electric motors. So summarizing the hypotheses, first hypothesis, magnetic fields of stars and planets are induced by the incoming Birkeland currents. The second hypothesis, rotation of stars and planets is due to cumulative effect of torque from incoming Birkeland currents. So, that's the story.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.